My name's Susan Nylon, and I'm your MC for this morning. I just saw Cooper Levy Baker come in early, so he'll be your MC for this afternoon. I am the owner of WSRQ Radio, and you can hear me every day on my station, 4 to 6 on the Nylon Report, and I'm happy to be here. This is my second year in returning, and I'm always thrilled because I have strong roots in the sustainable community here, and it's always thrilling that I see year after year this event do so well. I'm told to give you a couple of notes. There are bathrooms located in the main hall on the left side. There's also one upstairs that you can use in case the other one gets crowded. They do have recycling in this building. There are two blue bins over there. They ask you to please use them. And I'm also told that the first person to walk across the bridge out there to see the beautiful foliage will be kind enough to knock down all the spider webs that are there. We're just giving you a heads up. All right, this morning's agenda includes discussions on a number of topics that you'll find interesting and useful to you and your communities. We want to thank our sponsors for their generous support of today's workshop. Our silver level sponsors, Region Solar, Florida Department of Environmental Protection, Sarasota Bay Estuary Program, Southwest Florida Water Management District, Charlotte Harbor National Estuary Program, and our bronze level sponsors are the Sarasota County Green Business Partnership. What a great lineup of our supporting communities. If you're active in social media, please feel free to post throughout the day. The hashtag for the workshop is hashtag SCW14. And I'll remind you of that throughout the program because it's really good to get the message out there. Speakers are welcome to mention their Twitter handles in their talks. Please help the conversation going online to help spread the word. Speaking of the conversation going on, I hope you've completed your What I Want in My Sustainable Community sticker that you received when you checked in this morning. Ringling College of Art and Design's Tim Rummage is taking photos of the various stickers that we will share with all of you later in the day. Finally, please remember to silence your cell phones before we get started. Now it's my pleasure to introduce the chair of the Sarasota County Commission, who will be giving the opening remarks. Commissioner Charles Hines has served on the County Commission since 2012. He's an attorney in Venice and has been practicing law for 22 years in Sarasota County. His business experience includes directorship of the Venice Area Chamber of Commerce and as a previous co-owner of United Healthcare Services. His community and civic association activities include the Sertoma Club of Venice, United Way of South Sarasota, Big Brothers and Big Sisters, and the Venice Little League. He has also coached numerous youth football, baseball, and soccer teams. Commissioner Hines is currently serving on the Sarasota Bay and Charlotte Harbor National Estuary Committees and the National Association of the Sarasota County Green Business Partnership. The Southwest Florida Regional Planning Council and the Water Planning Alliance Board. He is deeply connected to the Sarasota through both his service and his family and is a true advocate of a growing sustainable community for all. Please join me in welcoming Commissioner Charles Hines.
Good morning. Thanks, Susan.
You're welcome.
I was talking to Lee Byron this morning a little bit, and are most folks here from Sarasota County or local, pretty much? Okay, good. How many have been to this event before? All right. I'm the fear of everyone is I may go a little off script here because of that. I feel like, you know, I'm speaking to our own community versus folks from outside. So I can use some examples that you may be familiar with, and we're doing this. But first of all, I'm going to give you some background on this event and this workshop, and give you some history, and then make a few comments and get some information from you all. So again, my pleasure as chairman of the County Commission to welcome you to this workshop. And this workshop's really been a true partnership among all of our local community leadership. So this event began as a grant from the U.S. Department of Energy in 2006. And has brought together incredible speakers at these workshops to inform and inspire our community on a variety of issues. The first workshop focused on sustainable transportation. Other workshop themes addressed home retrofits, water management strategies, and the green economy. So here's where I'm gonna get off script a little bit. So the first one dealt with sustainable transportation. And so I'll put us all on the spot here. How many people came here by public transportation this morning? Okay. How many people rode their bike here today? All right. We still got a lot to do. And so we recognize as a policy setter in the county commission, you know, our community is really in between. If you're New York City, public transportation's there. It's easy. You know, we have incredible density that it makes sense. If you live out in a farm in North Dakota and you got to drive 300 miles to work, running a bus system doesn't really make sense. We're in between. And so we're constantly, with the decisions that we make, are looking to ways that when our community, next 10, 20, 30 years, where are we going to be and how's public transportation going to work? So I ask you that. I didn't see anybody raise their hand. So coming to an event like this, we need to all ask ourselves, well, why didn't we use public transportation? Why didn't it make sense? I saw a couple ladies this morning bringing in bottles of water and all that. How would have they packed that on a scat bus? That would have been difficult. So let's keep that in mind as we go throughout today. The theme of this year's workshop is growing healthy, resilient, and prosperous communities. You will hear both local and national speakers sharing best practices on local food, improved public health, economic opportunities, and addressing our vulnerabilities as a coastal community. I heard today in the news, and I think you may remember this, but I think it's actually today's the second anniversary of Hurricane Sandy. And if you remember what that did to that coastal community, which you normally don't, at least I didn't, someone who grew up in Florida, don't think of the Northeast as having a hurricane issue, okay? So they are still dealing with that. And Laird from our, from Sarasota County is going to talk to you later about what we're trying to do in post-disaster type planning. It's not if, you know, it's when the hurricane hits us. How are we going to deal with it? How are we going to deal with it after it hits? And so we have some good plans that are being put in place right now to deal with that. You have an opportunity at the end of the workshop to come together and develop your own solutions. And our county commission truly values your input to identify priorities of future action. And that kind of goes back to what I was saying before. You know, when we meet, when you look at growth in Sarasota County, potential development, potential situations, whether it's inside the urban service boundary, outside the urban service boundary, how can we put your ideas effectively in place? And then the flip side of that is how can you when I say effectively, also efficiently in place? You know, we could have a bus running by here every 5 minutes and hopefully people would hop on it. But if they don't, then obviously your tax dollars are gonna, you know, your taxes will go up significantly. So that's the balance that we're always trying to work out. So your all's input to us, coming to us and say, hey, when you're making a policy decision, did you think about this? Can you add that? And so workshops like this are very helpful. From the perspective of Sarasota County government, we've seen the value of implementing sustainable practices for many years. In fact, earlier this year, we were honored to be chosen by the North American Host Committee for the World Environment Day. In just over 6 weeks, the partnering organizations hosted 55 events with 7,100 attendees. And I went to the event that was at Oscar Scheer State Park, and I can tell you that organization was very impressed with the proactive thinking that Sarasota County has done in trying to implement policies that you know, work for our community. Our residents have consistently shown us that sustainability is important to them through attendance at events like the World Environment Day. And your presence here today shows that too. In fact, the most recent annual citizen survey, 75% of the respondents said it's very important for county government to work on energy efficient consumption. So, as I walked in here today, and I was thinking through my mind how, you know, to ask you all the tough questions, I was glad to see, and this is funny, this is a male thing, but the urinals in here are the non-water, non-flush urinals. And, you know, that's something that if you just think back 10 or 20 years ago and you go to any public restrooms, you just saw all the water that was being wasted. And so I know from our county government, when we are building buildings, it may be more expensive to do some things, but we are thinking about it. We just approved money to build 4 new fire stations, and the way those are being built, all these sustainability type questions were asked and were being implemented in our new fire stations. Just this past fiscal year, Sarasota County educated 653 households on energy and water saving strategies and provided energy kits that will help these households save over $91,000 per year. Today you'll hear from Habitat for Humanity of South, what Habitat for Humanity of South Sarasota County is doing to help their clients reduce their energy costs dramatically. You also hear the importance of solid waste reduction strategies. Since a vote to adopt mandatory recycling in 1991, Sarasota County residents and businesses continue to embrace recycling. And when I travel throughout the state as a county commissioner and meet with other county governments, I'm still amazed that there are communities that don't do mandatory recycling. But it doesn't make a lot of sense, but there are. So maybe we can encourage them. In 2012, Sarasota County recognized that we're recognized for the highest traditional recycling rate. 47% of the total waste collected within the county was diverted from the landfill. And that's significant, just one, from the environment, but also as taxpayers in our community, the last thing we want to do is go around and build more landfills. The land's expensive. They smell bad, not as bad as they used to, but no one wants to live next to them. That property's taken off the tax rolls. And so the less landfills that we need is really significant when we plan for our future. With the momentum behind Eat Local Week this week, it's clear that local healthy food is also a priority. Sarasota County now has 8 community gardens, 46 school gardens, and a growing number of farmers markets, increasing the interest in gardening classes. I'm really going off topic here, but off the thing here, but I really had an interesting conversation with a person that was running for Sarasota County Commission last night about agriculture and what we're going to do in the future if land continues or development continues out east of Sarasota County. And the debate was, what's the role of government in that? And how do we address incentivizing farmers to continue to farm versus government telling them, you must farm, you can't sell your land? How do we create policies that we can keep local growers here growing food that can be sold locally here and help them put off the pressures from their families that suddenly say, you know, we've been farming for 4 or 5 generations. It's time to sell. You know, we're tired of farming. We want to move on. And the discussion that we had is, how can government create incentives to do that through conservation easements, potentially buying the land ourselves. So how we keep farming here local, or agriculture here local, is a debate that we need to have as our community grows. Our county also leads our community by example, installing solar panels on the community operations center, an extension of green building to cut down energy uses and costs. That's just another example of saying, as we are thinking about this, we are lucky enough to live in a community that our property values have gone up, and because of that, we've been able to have money and good fiscal management of your tax dollars that we've been able to begin building the infrastructure that has been needed. New emergency operations center is just up the road here. You go through Bee Ridge and just on your right-hand side, and so talking about hurricane preparedness, we will now have an emergency operations center that where it is right now, it's in the building, in the Ringling building, where our office is, you know, on the 6th floor. Hurricane 1 level winds, we have to move. So your emergency operations center has to go in emergency operation mode and move, okay? And we all saw what happened with Hurricane Charlie. It's gonna hit Tampa and it's only a Hurricane 1, no big deal. Boom, it turns, becomes a hurricane level, you know, level 3, level 4 like that. So our folks can't think that. They have to think worst case scenario. So that is being solved right now so that when the hurricane's going on, our folks have a safe place to work and be prepared that the moment it's over, they can get out and begin saving lives. Investing in fuel-saving technologies in our county fleet, including plug-in electric passenger cars and hybrid bucket trucks. Another spot. How many people came here in electric cars today? No? You got one. Well, Two drove here today, and you've spoken to us several times about it. Hopefully, in the next 3 or 4 years, when we keep having these, that we get more and more folks. And we've talked about putting plug-in stations at our county buildings to help facilitate that. So energy efficiency and green building technologies is a standard design criteria in the new county facilities, bringing taxpayer savings over the life of those facilities and healthier, more comfortable working environment for our employees and visiting public. You can see by these examples in the design of our new fire stations, emergency operations center, our new golf gate library, and many other facilities. So as we work together to reach a more sustainable community, workshops like these are important tools to meet and share information and discuss opportunities and move together toward common goals. We hope that through the expert speakers that you hear today, you'll discover new ways of improving sustainability and with your own home and with your business. So together, we can localize the economic impact and development and develop innovative ways to protect our environment and support improvements in health and for all members of our community. Now today, you know, how are we going to measure success of today? So this is the ninth one. So I think it's, what do we do with the information here? How does it get out to our community? So in 3 or 4 or 5 years, again, if someone asks you questions like I did today, there's a lot more hands, and that'll show that we've been a success. And I do want to let you know, from our county commission standpoint, you know, don't keep this information to yourself. Call us, set an appointment. Have us come to different meetings and say, hey, this is what we've learned. Here's what other communities are doing. How can we incorporate this here in Sarasota County? So sorry, Susan, I went a little longer, but I, you know, rather than just reading something to you, I did want you to know that this is something we think about all the time. So thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Hines, for your remarks and your role in keeping Sarasota County a leader in sustainability. Our keynote speaker this morning is Michael H. Shuman, an economist, attorney, author, entrepreneur, and a globally recognized expert on community economics. He is one of the architects of the crowdfunding reforms that became the Jobs Act, signed into law in April of 2012. Shuman is currently the director of community portals for Mission Markets and a fellow at the Cutting Edge Capital and Post-Carbon Institute. He's also a founding board member of the Business Alliance for Local Living Economies. Shuman has authored and co-authored 8 books. His most recent book is Local Dollars, Local Cents, How to Move Your Money from Wall Street to Main Street and Achieve Real Prosperity. In recent years, Shuman has prepared studies on the opportunities for food localization for states and counties around the country. He led another food study funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and the Kellogg Foundation, analyzing case studies of 24 local businesses worldwide. Shuman received an AB with distinction in economics and international relations from the Stanford University in 1979 and a JD from the Stanford Law School in 1982. He's also a member of the State Bar of California and the District of Columbia Bar. Michael will be speaking to us this morning about the powerful role of local food in job creation. Please give him a warm welcome, Michael H. Shuman.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I appreciate all of you taking time out of your busy days to think about these ideas together. It's one thing that was not mentioned in the resume that I have to kind of admit is I am an odd representative of talking about local food. In a moment of desperation when I was at Stanford, I took a job promoting Twinkies in the local supermarket, and I had to dress up like a giant Twinkie. So I had to put on yellow tights and a yellow shirt and walk up and down the aisles and say, do you know the Twinkies are now individually wrapped for freshness? And I kind of looked something like that. So the fact that I can be talking to you about local food means that any of you can talk about local food. Where I want to start is point out that there have been probably 100 studies done over the last 10 years that show the incredible job potential of promoting local food. This is a study that I did in the greater Cleveland area about 3 years ago with two other colleagues. And we showed that a 25% shift in local food consumption in the greater Cleveland area would create 27,000 new jobs, about $1 billion in new wages, and $126 million in new government tax collections. This would be enough in principle to reemploy 1 in 7 unemployed workers in the greater Cleveland area. And this is just localization, modest localization in one particular sector, food. Now, some of you may think that when you see a "we sell local food" insignia at, say, the local Walmart, this is part of the job creation. But in fact, local has two meanings. One meaning is proximity, being close to the farmer. That's good for a number of reasons, but that's not where the economic benefits come from. The economic benefits come from the local ownership of each and every piece of the chain from the farm to the consumer. And that is why local businesses, local food businesses, every single link of the food chain is really important. We also showed in the Cleveland study that local food has a tremendous impact on things that are harder to put economic numbers around, like public health. The Cleveland Health Clinic, which is one of the premier public health institutions in the United States, now makes local food one of its priorities. It recognizes that local food, especially going into food deserts, which a lot of Metro Cleveland is a great way of replacing processed and junk food with healthy, fresh, tasty local food, and it's a great way of fighting the epidemic levels of type 2 diabetes and obesity, especially in children. We know that local food is good for the environment. We could see that the spread of urban farming was a way of dealing with various kinds of urban messes. It was a way of, you know, converting, say, a junk piece of land into an urban farm is good for water quality, it is good for air quality, it is good for getting rid of rats and other insect vectors, it is good for controlling the climate. We also know that the spread of local farms in the region is commensurate with good stewardship. At the end of the day, the most important land stewards that we have are farmers. We also know that local food brings down the carbon footprint because the less distance that food travels, the less energy that's consumed, and the less carbon that's emitted. And local food has a tremendous impact on global image. Cleveland, for many years, had the image of the city whose river caught fire. In fact, there was a folk song written about it called "Burn On, Cuyahoga." And what local food has done in Cleveland, and they've been, you know, there's incredible things happening in Cleveland with local food, it has changed the image into someone like Iron Chef Michael Simons. And this, of course, is great, not just in the public image of the city, but also in the economic development of the city. More people, more companies want to locate there. We found in our study, as many of the other studies have done, that there are some big challenges with local food. And I just want to name them quickly. There's the challenge of land. It is extremely difficult to grow all or most of your food in an urban area because of limits of land. Consumer demand. How do you convince more people to buy more local food more of the time? Entrepreneurship. How do we train a new generation of farmers and local food enterprise leaders? Competitiveness. How do we make sure that local food businesses are as competitive as the big businesses that they are mobilized against. And finally, capital. How do we make sure there is the right amount of capital in the hands of these new or expanding farms and local food businesses? So I want to suggest that all of these problems actually can be overcome, and we know a lot right now about how to overcome them. What about land? Well, honestly, we have barely scratched the surface, literally, of where you can grow food. You go to cities like Toronto and you see the entire rooftops of this city growing food right now. We see the beginnings of technologies for growing food on the sides of buildings. We barely use the land on the sides of highways and other fields. I mean, do you even have an inventory of the kind of land that is available in this, you know, relatively sprawling area that could be used for local food production? But that's just part of the solution. Any limit of land can be solved by thinking regionally. So the more that you think in a multi-county arrangement, the more likely it is you will be able to grow a substantial amount of your own food. There's also the issue of how the existing farmland is used. Most of your existing farmland is used for export. If some of that were converted to local consumption, the land problem could be solved. There's also a diet issue. The more that people shift from a very meat-intensive diet into a somewhat less meat-intensive mixed diet, that also brings down the land requirements for local food. Consumer demand. You may have noticed that everywhere in the country there is a movement now promoting buy local. I go around the country and speak all the time. I speak in rural and urban areas, red states and blue states. Every single city I come into, there is a sign that says, you know, farmers market, local bank, local food restaurant. There is no place I've ever gone to that says, we are not local, buy from us. That shows how far we have come with this movement. The next stage of this movement is clever business designs, and I'm going to talk about this later today, but clever business designs that allow us to promote these objectives in a self-financing kind of way. So I'll give you two examples. Supportland is a privately run local loyalty card in Portland. 50,000 Portland residents carry this card. Every time they use the card at a local business, they get points that they accumulate for discounts at other businesses. Bernal Bucks is a local debit card issued by a local credit union in Bernal Heights, San Francisco. They have allocated most of the fee associated with the card to the local business group to promote local purchasing. So, you know, very clever ways one can begin to push consumers to buy more local more of the time. Entrepreneurship. We've got a whole mess of really great entrepreneurship programs in the country, courses, mentorship programs, incubators, kitchen-oriented incubators, the emergence of farm schools. We know how to do this. This is not a big issue. Competitiveness. This is a big issue. How do we render local businesses more competitive? And one argument that I would make is actually local businesses are far more competitive than you think. If it were the case that local businesses were becoming less competitive in the last 10, 15 years, we would have seen jobs move out of the local business sector and into the large, non-local business sector. And in fact, this is the record in the United States. The black stripe is home-based businesses. The white stripe underneath there is businesses with under 100 employees. And this is a percentage breakdown of jobs in the US economy. The blue stripe is technically small businesses, 100 to 500 employees. Those first three stripes are 99.9% locally owned. The only non-local businesses are in that bottom stripe of 500 employees and above. Note there's been almost no change whatsoever. Almost no change whatsoever, which shows that a lot of what people talk about with globalization is pure hype. Local businesses have remained remarkably competitive during this period. You can even see this with the profit rates. The most recent data released from U.S. statistics show that the profit rates of sole proprietorships, which most small local businesses either are or start out as, are 7 times greater than the profit rates of C corporations, which most larger businesses are. And you can see this even more clearly in recent data from Canada, its economy is not all that different than our own. And what it shows is that the profit rates of 10 to 20 employee businesses are the highest profit rates in the economy. The lowest profit rates, by the way, are the largest businesses that are traded on the Toronto Stock Exchange. Go figure. When you talk specifically about local food businesses, what you're seeing is a bunch of fascinating new techniques that people are using in order to help local businesses improve their competitiveness still further. So, in the introduction of me, it was mentioned that I led a study done by the Gates and Kellogg Foundations that looked at 24 great local food businesses all around the world. This study, by the way, you can download at communityfoodenterprise.org. And cover looks like that. I think it reveals dozens of different techniques that local businesses are using to be more competitive. I just want to share 4 of them with you. One is collaboration. There is no economy of scale that a local food business can't reach if it collaborates with other local food businesses, or in this case, farmers. This is a picture from Indian Springs Co-op in rural Mississippi. It's 3 dozen African American farmers who've been working together since the days of the Civil Rights Movement. They collectively have built their own food hub to gather, clean, process, distribute food worth about $500,000. And because of their collaboration, they've been able to stay in business. Because of their collaboration, they have been able to move about $5,000 to $10,000 of business into 6 of the poorest rural counties in the United States, in Mississippi. Number 2, quality. We know that local businesses generate fresher food, tastier food. That's why we love it. A guy who embodies this is Andrew Akawenze, a Canadian Native American. Andrew has his own fishing business. He smokes his own fish. He brings it to farmers markets. His fish is so good, it's celebrated by Slow Food International, their chef's movement. He says, by the time my competitors are getting the bone out of fish, my customers are eating my fish smoked. And this is how he is able to maintain his competitive advantage. And indeed, most local food embraces this. Number 3, distribution. This is a picture from the Oklahoma Food Cooperative. Now, there are probably, several hundred food hubs in the United States that do various kinds of distribution. This one is very interesting because it is organized as a co-op. It's been around for about 10 years. They've done $6 million of delivery to date. And their design is that once a month, there is an exquisite ballet that takes about 4,000 products from 90 different food providers, some farmers, some food manufacturers, and delivers them to 52 pickup sites in the state. This design has greatly brought down the cost of food distribution. And I want to pause for a second and point out that Even when global businesses, global food businesses, are highly competitive on the production front, they are highly inefficient when it comes to distribution. So this graph here roughly shows what has happened to a dollar spent on food at a local market. And back in the year 1900, about 40 cents of the dollar was spent on the farmer. And the rest went to inputs and distribution. And by distribution, I mean everything from packaging, transportation, insurance, if you throw in processing, would be there as well, refrigeration, marketing, retail markup, and so forth. Today, so if I extend this out a little bit further, about 7 cents goes to the farmer. And more than 70 cents goes to distribution. So it doesn't take a rocket scientist to realize that whenever you have a situation like this, even if you have really expensive production, say instead of 7 cents, it's 14 cents, if you can get rid of most of that 70 cents of garbage in distribution, you have cheaper food and more income coming into farmers. And guess what? The Oklahoma Food Co-op achieves 18 cents per dollar on distribution. Speed. Lawrence Meats in Cannon Falls, Minnesota is a good example of the way that a local small business can be speedy, can deliver a product just in time without needless storage, inventory, overhead. It has a small-scale, multi-species processing plant. They process beef, elk, bison, I guess the occasional moose that strays in there. They don't do chickens, but they've gotten a USDA license, and they teach other communities how to set up these sort of mid-scale meat processing plants, and this is how they are competitive. Let's talk briefly about capital. One of the conclusions that we had in the Cleveland study was that to achieve the 25% shift, you would need roughly $750 million of new capital. Now that sounds like a lot of money, but it turns out that $750 million is 1% of the total amount Clevelanders had in their savings accounts in banks. And $750 million was 0.25% of what Clevelanders had invested in their pension accounts. So a shift of even a tiny amount of money from our existing patterns of either saving in banks or saving through our pension funds can make a huge difference in unlocking this job's potential from local food. I want to give you some examples of this. In my most recent book, Local Dollars, Local Cents, I have about 100 examples like these. I do all-day workshops to teach people about these. I just want to share five now, and those of you who are around tonight, I'll share some more. First one is specialty CDs. We have examples of people who go to their local bank or credit union and say, we want more lending to local food enterprises. We don't want you to put your capital at risk. We'll put our capital at risk. We'll create for you at the bank a specialized certificate of deposit, and then we will tell you who should get the loans. And if it does well, great, you get your administrative fees. If the money gets lost, we have it fully collateralized, and you get your administrative fees. Banks usually think this is a cool idea. So this picture here is from Equal Exchange, fair trade coffee organization company in Boston. They approached their local bank, started as Eastern, as Wainwright recently became Eastern Bank, and they created a specialized CD to support fair trade coffee. The result is that Equal Exchange now has a $1 million line of credit at the local bank. Why don't you folks start to approach your local banks to create special local food CDs and then encourage people to put money on deposit there. Co-ops. Co-ops has been one of the institutions where we've seen a lot of local investment. This is Weaver Street Market. Carrboro, North Carolina has 13,000 members. When they wanted to build a third store, they needed $1 million. They wanted to borrow it from their members, and they agreed to pay their members 6-7% per year for the privilege of borrowing their members. And the payments, the interest payments, were so much greater than what banks were offering. Members instantly took this up. And so I would think about, you know, how does one approach our co-op in doing various kinds of local investments to expand the local food infrastructure? LION. LION stands for the Local Investment Opportunities Network of Port Towns in Washington. This guy, James Fraser, had been a successful hedge fund manager in New York, got very wealthy, felt a little guilty about it, came back to Port Townsend to do an interesting innovation. And it turns out that under securities laws, even after you've put, you know, $50,000, $100,000 into securities work, you still may only be able to sell your securities, your stock or your debt notes, to investors with whom you have a pre-existing relationship. So what Fraser has done in Port Townsend is very smart. He has a monthly party, invites local businesses, local investors, mostly food businesses. He plies them with free food and alcohol, and at the end of each evening, he has a checkoff list, with whom do you now have a pre-existing relationship? And so when he gets a business plan, he knows exactly who he can share that with. Just this one little social invention has brought $1 million per year in local investing into local businesses, primarily local food businesses, since 2008. That is, right in the midst of the financial crisis, $1 million a year, a 10,000-person community. What would this do in a 300,000+ person county like you live in? I think you can do the math. Kickstarter. Kickstarter is a donation crowdfunding site, Indiegogo, and there's 100 other kind of local knockoffs like this. Here's their offering for Brickside Brewery, Copper Harbor, Michigan's first microbrewery. If you give them $1, you get a thank you note. If you give them $25, you get a t-shirt. If you give them $1,000, you get the beer named after you. The thank you note, the t-shirt, the beer. These things, from the Securities and Exchange Commission standpoint, are not considered valuable returns on your investment. So this is a total and legal dodge of securities laws. Now, economists and business people would say, who the heck would give money for a t-shirt? And the answer is, last year on Kickstarter, $500 million worth of people. And that's not counting the rest of the sites out there. So this kind of option for expanding your business without lawyers is available. Investment clubs. We have lots of examples, primarily linked with the organization Slow Money, of groups of civilians who come together, pool money, and then start investing together. And the key thing is, you can't have an investment advisor. You have to all do it kind of at an equal grassroots level. But this is an example of an investment club in Maine called No Small Potatoes. Every one of the 20 members kicks in $5,000, and collectively they vet farmers and food businesses for lending their money. As I said, we'll talk more about these later. Where I want to leave you this morning, though, is the same place where I end my book, Local Dollars, Local Cents, which is with a children's book called A Blue So Blue by Jean-Francois Dumont. And the book is about a boy who is obsessed with painting the color blue. Everywhere he goes, he paints blue, but there's one shade of blue that kind of comes to him in his sleep, mesmerizes him, and he can't figure out where the shade of blue comes from. So he goes on an international journey. He goes to the Louvre to find that color of blue, not there. He goes to look at various patches of water. No, the blue is not there either. He goes to a blues bar in New Orleans. Nope, not there. Then he meets a blue-hooded stranger in the desert. And the stranger says, what you've been looking for may never have been very far away. And it dawns on the boy, the blue that he was looking for, that came to his sleep, that had totally mesmerized him, that he had, you know, traveled so far to find, was actually the blue in his mother's eyes. And I feel like we so often forget that the wealth that we are trying to obtain, the financial wealth, the jobs, cannot be achieved through some far-fetched, exorbitant, attract and retain mega deal. It comes right in our own backyard, and if we start with food, we will get it right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. All right, I would like to now explain how we handle the Q&A throughout the day. We will leave 10 minutes at the end for each panel of questions and answers. To be sure we get the most questions possible, there are Q&A cards on each table. And you, of course it says to hold it up and I took it down, sorry. Are you listening to presentation? As you are listening to presentations, please make note of any questions that you have for the speakers on those cards and hold them up in the air and a volunteer will come and pick them up. At the end of the session, I will read the questions and ask the panelists to respond. Please make a note indicating who the question is for, as in a specific speaker on the panel. Now it's time to introduce the speakers for our first panel. They will share their experiences and innovation on local food. First, on our local food panel this morning is Don Hall, the founder and director of Transition Sarasota, a grassroots nonprofit organization dedicated to cultivating local communities' resilience and self-reliance in food, economy, energy, and more. Don, come on up. All right, our next panelist is Carmen Franz, Community Food Project Coordinator for the Florida Organic Growers. They'll speak about the Agricultural Justice Project and a statewide farmers market SNAP incentive program that encourages food stamp recipients to use their own benefits at the farmers market to buy locally grown Florida produce. You can come up.
Come up here.
Yeah. And finally, Karen Bell, Starfish Company, Cortez Village, will talk about local seafood, local fishermen, and the importance of historic Cortez Village on one of the last working waterfronts in Florida. I look forward to hearing from this diverse panel. And Don Hall, will you get us started? Wait. I'm not. They come down there? All right, but the panelists stay up here. Okay, I'm really bad at this, apparently.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, good morning, everybody. Some of you have heard me speak here before about local food, and so I wanted to talk about what's new, what's emerging, and what's yet to come, and where this might all go. Using the theme of putting local food on the map. That is the theme for this year's Eat Local Week, of which this event is a part. And I think you will see by the end of the presentation why that is a very apt theme for where we are currently at in the local food movement here in Southwest Florida. Just very briefly, I want to touch on why we eat local. There are many different doorways into the local food movement. We could think about health, sustainability, security, economy, and community. Food brings us together like nothing else. So lots of great reasons to do this that most of us already know. But still there's this question. What is local? We saw the sign at Walmart advertising local produce in Michael's presentation. Well, what local means to us here and for the purposes of our Eat Local Resource Guide and Directory, we chose a specific definition that was Sarasota and the adjoining counties. So Sarasota, Manatee, Charlotte, and DeSoto. Reason why we came up with this is probably about as far as somebody would drive to get their food. Now this is just an arbitrary definition, and there are expanding circles outside of that. We're not talking about everything coming from within this small circle. So our Eat Local Resource Guide and Directory came out about two and a half weeks ago now. We had 6,000 copies printed of the first print edition. It first went online in April of 2011, and you can actually pick up a printed copy at the back table during the break. I want to use the directory as a frame to talk about where our local food movement has been and where it's going. So in April 2011, when we launched the guide, this is what our local food system looked like, more or less. We had 98 different listings. But about a year and a half later, that had grown to 136. And then 2 years later, to 253. If we look at this, for some reason my graph is not showing up, but you have to believe me that there are bars representing those three time periods and a trend line that shows that our local food system has been growing by about 33% a year on average. Which is huge. This is a trend that shows no sign of slowing down. I want to talk about what's happening specifically. What is going on? What are the trends? What's coming next? And what we have to work on here locally. So in reference to emerging trends, one of them has been more businesses working in providing local meats and fish. One of the major trends within this is that we have more pastured, grass-fed animal production. Just in the last year alone, I can think of four different businesses that have gotten started that are doing grass-raised pastured meats. Two of them have been started by U.S. Army veterans. Another one is a good friend of mine who is starting out in his backyard but is looking to expand beyond that. And the other emerging trend in this area is on-site processing. One of those veterans started Three Sons Farm down in Punta Gorda, just over the line in Charlotte County. It is now the largest bison farm, grass-fed, in the entire southeastern United States. It's only started about a year ago, and they have an on-site USDA-approved processing facility that now they are lending out to other businesses to do local processing so they don't have to ship it away, and so that local farms can retain some control over how their meat is processed. Beer, wine, and spirits. We many of us probably know that this is a major emerging trend here. A couple of the markers on this map are for wineries. One is for a distillery, and one is for a brewery that was open, has been open for a long time. The remainder, five different new breweries have opened in the past year. So lots of local craft breweries. We're talking about Darwin's Brewing Company, Motorworks, Big Top, J-Dubs, and Fat Point down also in Punta Gorda. And thankfully, they're really, really good. They're winning all sorts of national and international awards. And this is something definitely to celebrate that's going on in our local food system right now. A place where I feel like we have room to grow and that there's potential to move farther in this direction. We do have some great wholesalers here in town, but as Michael talked about, a local food hub and aggregation and distribution center for specifically for local food from local farmers, that is something that we don't quite have yet. But a lot of discussion going on around this, and I expect to see this happen in the near future. And this will facilitate the mainstreaming of local food. Not all people want to go to the farmers market to buy just a few items and then have to go do their grocery shopping elsewhere. Local food hub would help get that local food into supermarkets to where people are already shopping and make this the norm rather than something special that we go do once a week. Prepared foods, also something really on the increase. We're seeing more and more cottage industry, very small businesses. And with the right kind of support and capital, these are businesses that could expand rapidly. And this is important because we do live a fast lifestyle in this country. We talk a lot about slow food in the local food movement, and that is very important. The fact that many people in our country have given up on cooking at all is something that needs to be reversed. But on the other hand, we do have this fast lifestyle, and so to have products that do not need excessive preparation is, I think, something that will help local food expand outward and reach more people. And then finally, related services. This is also another area ripe for growth. We have a lot of potential for edible landscaping. More and more people are starting gardens. Commissioner Hines talked about the community gardens, and there's about a new one starting every year in this area. But some people also don't want to spend the time to grow their own garden. And I think that there's a real opportunity for entrepreneurs to step into that opportunity and start edible landscaping businesses. And farm incubator, something else that Michael mentioned in his talk briefly. This is something that we need in terms of training entrepreneurs to start new farms and start new local food businesses, a hub for training these entrepreneurs. And very quickly, here's some areas that we can work on. Farmers markets have been really strong in this area. We actually have a lot more markets than this that call themselves farmers markets, but some of them have no local farmers at them. When I lived in Boulder, Colorado, there were two farmers markets for the whole county, but they were nothing but local farmers. So we need to increase the number of local growers, and I think that this can be done, given that more and more of these businesses are starting every year. And we need to be open to competition. The idea that this is a zero-sum game in putting multiple growers into a single farmer's market, we need to rethink that and reframe that and think about growing the pie bigger so everybody can have a bigger slice. And then finally, restaurants. We have lots of great local restaurants, many that are supporting local farmers. You'll go in, practically every restaurant in town will say, we are sourcing produce from our local farmers. We get the freshest seasonal ingredients. And that's great, but we have to ask, how much local sourcing are they doing? Are they just getting strawberries when they're in season from Plant City? Or is there a regular ongoing relationship with our local farmers? And from where are they sourcing? What is local? I think we need to get more specific about that, because some people's definition of local is Florida. Some people's definition is the southeastern United States. And we need to be supporting the restaurants that are really making an effort to localize and build those relationships with local farmers. So what are we aiming at? Transition Sarasota, my organization, has promoted for several years now a 10% local food shift pledge. Less than the 25% that Michael looked at in some of his studies. But I think that this is a very significant goal. And the last study that was done about our local food system showed that only in Sarasota County, if all residents bought just 10% more of their food from a local farmer, that would add $80 million a year to our local economy. That's literally thousands of new green permanent jobs. So what would that look like? I didn't have the time to put together the whole animation here, but imagine 10 times. We're probably at, there's different estimates and we don't really know, but we're probably, to be generous, around 1% in terms of the food that we produce that we consume here locally. So imagine this, every one of these markers being multiplied 10 times over, or 2,530 listings. We would, at that point, dispense with the local guide because it would be so widespread that people would know where their local farmers markets are, where their local farmers are. This was a study that Michael produced for an organization that I used to work for, Transition Colorado, out in Boulder, Colorado. And it had a very large impact there, apparently inspiring the mayor to add to their sustainability goals 20% food localization by 2020. That was the mayor of Denver. And I think we can do the same thing here. This is one of the reasons why we wanted to bring Michael here, was hopefully to have a new food study done for this area. And I know it's easy because I created this in about 15 minutes with Photoshop last night. But all we need is the financing, and I believe that this could provide a roadmap to a more strategic and well-resourced approach to building our local food shed. Thank you very much.
Okay, we're gonna try this again. Don't forget that if you have any questions for Don, go ahead and put it on the card, which I brought up. And we'll come around and collect it, and then when I bring them back up on the panel, we'll ask your questions. All right, now let me bring up Carmen Franz, Community Food Project Coordinator for Florida Organic Growers. She'll speak about the Agricultural Justice Project and statewide farmers market SNAP incentive program that encourages food stamp recipients to use their benefits at farmers market to buy Florida-grown produce. Thank you, Carmen.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to speak to you today about two separate projects that are independent from themselves, but both are related to our organization. I wanted to start off with, who is Florida Organic Growers? Raise your hand if you've heard of us before. Okay, so quite a few. So our full title is Florida Certified Organic Growers and Consumers. My boss, Marty Mesh, the executive director, really liked the acronym FOG, so people typically know us by FOG. We started in 1987 to promote sustainable, organic, and fair farming in Florida. And we have a lot of work that we do locally in Alachua County, where we're based, to promote local food systems, but we do work statewide and internationally. So our organization is broken into two sections. One is quality certification services that certifies organic farms in 13 countries, and then the other side is outreach and education, which is the side that I work under. In Gainesville, we have an urban farm that grows food for a local homeless shelter. We also build raised bed vegetable gardens in low-income families' backyards and teach them how to grow. And for the past 5 years, we've been running the food stamp program, which is processed through electronic benefits transfer, which is EBT, at two farmers markets in Alachua County. Statewide, we do a lot of local food system development. One of our biggest projects is doing on-farm workshops with growers. So we try to train the next generation of growers, but also help conventional farmers transition to organic to reduce or eliminate their use of pesticides. And then the other program that's statewide is the one that I manage, which is Fresh Access Bucks. Related to food system development, we were able to get a local food promotion program grant to do a year of planning for a North Central Florida farmer cooperative. So we work a lot with networking growers and helping them to organize to better sell their products. And we are also going to be going after the Beginning Farmer and Rancher grant next year to start a farm incubator for our state. Just a heads up. And a lot of our partners statewide are working on food hubs. So we have a group in St. Petersburg that got the local food promotion program grant to start a food hub, which is pretty close to you guys here. And then our partners in Tallahassee got a grant similar to start one there. And there's a group in Jacksonville organizing for a food hub and also down in Broward County. So our state is really coming together, and it's gonna be exciting to see how local food changes in the next 10 years. So the first thing I'm going to briefly talk about is the Agricultural Justice Project. This is a nonprofit organization that is a partnership of several nonprofits that was kind of born out of Florida Organic Growers, and now it's applying for its own 501c3 status, so it's kind of graduating from us. But basically, AJP started the food justice certification a few years back. And basically, it was born out of the need to address farm worker rights in our state and nationally. So this is the first domestic fair trade label in our country. And it's kind of a theme that's frequently left out of the local food movement, talking about farm worker rights. And you know, the majority of the food produced on conventional farms that you find in your grocery store, a lot of it has a deep history of harvest of shame, if you will, for farm worker rights. So this is more of a consumer-driven, like a market solution to enable consumers to identify fair products. And these are some of the things the certification addresses, which it's very in-depth, and I encourage you to check out the website if you're interested. And on the FOG website, we do have a short documentary that's 15 minutes long that talks about the certification and the situation in the country. But in Florida, we only have one food justice certified farm in the family garden up in around Gainesville. I think it's in Alachua County. And he's food justice certified. And I'd be happy to give you more details on that. But the majority of what I'm going to speak with you today is, what is Fresh Access Bucks? So back in 2013, after we'd been running the EBT program in Alachua County for several years, we decided that we wanted to expand access to farmers markets across the state to encourage food stamp recipients to use their benefits at local markets. So basically, a shopper with a food stamp card can spend $20 at a participating market and get $40 to spend on Florida-grown produce. We were originally funded by a specialty crop block grant from the Florida Department of Agriculture with two goals in mind. First, we wanted to divert some of the federal nutrition assistance benefits that come to Florida to support Florida farmers, and we wanted to increase their revenues. And second, we wanted to help underserved communities access healthier food. So we all know that the most nutrient-poor foods are frequently the cheapest, so this was an effort to make healthy foods affordable and accessible for low-income families in our state. And currently, we have about $6 billion that come to Florida for federal nutrition assistance benefits, and less than 1% is used towards Florida farmers. So we're trying to divert, even if we get to 1%, it would have an incredible ripple effect on our local economy, not to mention all the reduction of chronic diseases. So how it works. We got funded to do 20 markets statewide, and we already have all of our 20. A few of them are in this area. We have the Venice Farmers Market's one of our partners, the Englewood Farmers Market, and the Punta Gorda Farmers Market in this area are all participants. And basically, they run a snap booth where a shopper with a snap card will come, swipe, and convert into tokens to shop at the market, and the vendors accept the tokens as they would money, and then they get reimbursed by the market at the end of market day. And the tokens don't expire, and there's no change given, so they can always come back later with their tokens for whatever they don't spend. So we're partners with a national organization called Wholesome Wave, that are one of the leaders in these programs. The other major organization that you've probably heard of is Fair Food Network, that does the Double Up Bucks program in Michigan. And so they'd been doing this for several more years than FOG, and so when we developed our program, we kind of followed their example, so we didn't have to reinvent the wheel. And they had been collecting data on these programs for a very long time. And so all of our market managers keep track of the number of SNAP recipients that come to the market, whether or not they're new, so we could tell if we're drawing new people to the market, how much they spend on fruits and vegetables, and how much they spend on other SNAP-related products. And after aggregating all that data and doing surveys and research nationwide, they found that 90% of customers report increasing their consumption of fruits and vegetables. So the neatest thing about this program is that it does create real behavior change, and it found that if food is accessible and affordable, people do want to feed their families healthy food. I feel like I might be preaching to the choir, but and when you shop at farmers markets, the food tastes better. It's phenomenally different than the apple you see in a gas station. And so fresher, recently harvested food, not only is it more nutrient dense, but it has better flavor, which encourages greater consumption. The other thing that they found nationwide was that because of increased revenue, farmers actually diversify their products, increase acreage, build new hoop houses because they've been able to make such a significant more amount of money from participating in programs like this. And the USDA did a study that found that for every $5 in SNAP benefits spent in a local community, there's a $9.20 ripple effect. It means the money stays in the local community, and there's a multiplier effect that makes economies more resilient in economic downturns. So we've been at this for a little bit over a year now, and we've been able to bring over $150,000 in healthy food purchased across the state to Florida farmers. We're currently at 20 markets. I just trained our 20th market yesterday, so I didn't update that. But we've had over 6,000 transactions, over 2,500 new shoppers, and over 150 participating farmers statewide. And so we are currently going after a major grant in the Farm Bill that I'll get into in the next slide, which is called the Food Insecurity Nutrition Incentive Program. We have 20 markets currently, but we want to expand by 10 markets every year. And I have a waiting list of about 50 markets right now, but it's all contingent on grant funding and how well we're able to fundraise we'll be able to add new markets. But this is essentially our goal over the next 3 years. And so based on the success of our partners nationwide, they were able to get this new program in the Farm Bill. So it represents the first time that there's been federal legislation to support incentive programs. And they're really trying to focus on the evaluation piece about how these programs can impact behavior change and get people to use their benefits at markets to be healthier. So we're looking at raising quite a bit of money to reach that goal. We want to provide more nutrition education to our partners. So a lot of our farmers markets do cooking demos at the markets or offsite at a community center. So it's not just about, here's your kohlrabi, but what do you do with it? And how do you prepare it? So all of our cooking demos typically have five or less ingredients or are made with $4 or less and stuff sourced from the market. So we try to make it as practical and applicable as possible. And then what we realized too is that frequently farmers market managers don't have a lot of capacity to run extra programs and do the outreach that it takes to bring shoppers with SNAP cards to the market. So we're trying to raise some funds so that they can have a little bit more part-time staff to make the programs more successful. So if you or anyone you know thinks that this might be of interest of increasing access for underserved communities and supporting Florida farmers, we are looking for partners in this effort, and our grant is due in December. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to share more information with you, and that is all I've got. Thank you.
Okay, and don't forget, those questions can be put on the card, and we will have them given out when we do our Q&A board. All right. And oh, my script got messed up. Okay, and finally, Karen Bell, Starfish Company Cortez Village, will talk about local seafood, local fishermen, and the importance of historic Cortez Village, one of the last working waterfronts in Florida. Let's welcome her, please.
I am here to speak with you a little bit about fishing, which of course is very local. And I'm always amazed at how many people don't really realize how big a part of Manatee County that commercial fishing is. I give tours to school children throughout the year, mostly in the spring. And often I see those kids later and later in their lives. And they tell me what an impact it made on them as a little kid, because they come through and they see the fishermen, and they're always very unusual and memorable. And then the boats, of course, and it's a day out on the coast, so people really seem to enjoy that. But what I'm going to do is just tell you a little bit about what our local part of this equation is. And then I'm going to share with you some of the things my dad told me about supporting our local community, because it's interesting how wise he was. And it makes me think of when I got out of school, he gave me these rules, and much of which was to support your local environment and, you know, spread what you do in a local manner as much as possible. These first two slides basically just show Cortez. I don't know how many of you know where the historic village is, but it's on the northern perimeter of Sarasota Bay. This, I believe, is a 1940 aerial, and you'll see that's the wooden bridge that used to run from where the current bridge is basically now over to Bridge Street on Bradenton Beach. And then this is looking at it more from the south perspective, but Cortez is, that's our fish house. If you look above the center icon there, that's our facility today. But the village, it's really interesting because people often say as they drive into the village how much it takes them back in time. It looks very much today like it did 100 years ago. My grandmother was born there in 1900, and my grandfather came from the Carolinas in the 1880s. The house is still the same. The fish houses, of course, have grown and look a little bit different, but basically the same. The interesting thing about our company is we are doing today almost the same thing that my grandfather did back in the 1920s. Aaron Parks Bell is AP Bell Fish Company. He came to Cortez from North Carolina. He chose Cortez because he and many of the other originators of the village there, because of the natural barrier islands that are now Longboat Key, Bradenton Beach, Holmes Beach, and Anna Maria Island. They chose to build on the mainland because they viewed, which was wise again, they viewed those coastal beaches as protection against storms. In North Carolina, they had experienced a lot of horrific hurricane impacts. So they came to the mainland, built their homes and their fish houses. But again, today we do the same thing that they were doing then, which was buying and selling fish. Primarily back in the early 20s and 30s, I have all these old ledgers where they were buying mullet 3 cents a pound. They were buying trout 5 cents a pound. The same thing we do today, but we pay a little bit more, just a little bit. In the 70s, my dad started every other year building a grouper boat, which today most everyone in Florida knows what grouper is. Lots of places outside of Florida really aren't aware. In New York, we ship twice a week to New York and Canada grouper. But other than that, Florida is grouper is a Florida product. These are some of the boats. They're named after the girls. Lisa's my sister. Kalijah was Karen, Lisa, Jeff, my brother and sister. But all the boats were named after girls until we ran out of girls, and then they went to Liberty Bell, She's a Bell, and there's Liberty, cute, right? there is that Karen, that's my namesake. She needs a bottom job, looks like. Rachel's my cousin. The interesting thing, though, about this is that this fishery developed over time, the grouper fishery in the 70s. We primarily do three types of local fish. I mean, we buy and sell pretty much anything that the guys catch. A couple women fishermen, not quite as many. But grouper is probably one of our largest production items. Mullet. Very big stone crab and shrimp, so actually four. That's a bait boat. Alice Bell is named after my grandmother. Okay, I wanted to spend a little bit of time talking about mullet, because that, as far as a local fish, it's a huge item, especially historically. People years ago in the South, mainly Georgia, Florida, huge mullet consumers. Do you all even know what mullet are? Okay, good, because it's really sad when I hear people come mostly from out of state and they'll say, well, that's a bait fish or that's a trout or a trash fish. And I'm like, oh, you're so wrong, because if it's prepared correctly, and if you're not a cook and you ever want a really good mullet, go to Starfish Company. Right now is just the perfect time of the year to enjoy mullet, because they're real fatty. They're coming into their spawning season in December, so right now the fish are just really fat, high in omega-3 oils, and they're at their best for eating, and we do a beautiful job either blackening or frying or grilling sometimes. But anyway, these next few shots are just of the roe fishery. And again, what I wanted to impress upon you all is how much people around the world value mullet compared to our own economy now. I mean, true Southerners seem to appreciate mullet, but much of our production today goes to Colombia, Egypt, Romania, Haiti, places where food is valued for its nutritious nutrient content and its price. Mullet's inexpensive. You can buy mullet in most markets for $1 to $2 a pound, and it's truly, if you enjoy fish, it's good. It's got the higher oil content, so it's a stronger flavor than some fish, more in line with a mackerel, but it's good for you and inexpensive. So we try to encourage people, that's Tony, his son Michael, a lot of people take their families, the kids go mullet fishing with them. Andrus, old Palmetto family, been there 100 years. It's a fishery that's really steeped in tradition. There's a mullet for you, nice example. And what we're seeing now is North Carolina is just opening up for mullet. The fish, as it's cooler up there, the fish start spawning earlier. They'll move down the coast. Jacksonville will be next. North Florida, Louisiana is right now. And then we'll start seeing roeing fish, meaning the egg-bearing fish, in December. These pictures are taken, I think, a couple of years ago. That is roe. Again, a true Southern specialty that my grandfather used to, they would dry them outside, exactly what they're doing today in Europe, big in Spain. Tonight I have a customer flying in from Spain, and he'll be here for a few days. And they truly are huge roe buyers over there. Spain, Italy, we ship to Sardinia. Taiwan, they enjoy roe, and also Egypt last year was a buyer of roe. But again, it's kind of odd how it's come, or kind of shifted away from our citizenry. They don't really like this flavor. It's a very strong, fishy flavor, salty. It's basically a caviar or, you know, an eggs. But a lot of local people don't find it, you know, they just don't seem to enjoy it that much. But how they do make it is they dry it and press it. It's outdoors, and you want a dry day, and it takes a number of days to get that consistency. You'll see it on the food channel even now. It's becoming more common around here. But they'll grate it over pasta in Italy or over salads, or I've had it where our customer from Sardinia, he would slice it paper thin and put it on a water cracker with like a little bit of olive oil. Really good when it's served in a light way like that. Fried is always a way that that local Southerners kind of had it. This was our crew loading a container to Egypt last year. We shipped 200,000 pounds of male mullet to Egypt. The interesting thing about mullet that I want to share with you all is the female mullet are way, way more valuable. As in life, females are, from my perspective, are a lot more valuable. That's not very nice, but anyway, this is 200,000 pounds, four containers going to Port Said, Egypt, and I had the crew, I make them do this, it drives them crazy. I sent it to our customer, whose name is Abbas, and he was just here about 2 weeks ago, just getting ready for this season, but they have to hand stack these containers, 50,000 pounds in a container, which is 2,000 boxes, 25-pound boxes, whatever that is, I have to divide, 2,500 boxes. Anyway, hand stacked because, oddly enough, you can't ship pallets to Egypt. And I really don't get it because I don't see, it has something to do with, they think, termites or they don't want to infiltrate their system with anything. But yet the cardboard boxes that you would think would be the same thing, maybe not, I don't know, but that's interesting. Just slushed mullet. More mullet, 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 mullet. I probably didn't have to include so many mullet. That's just some rendering of an artist did at the dock, really pretty. I included this picture because I just wanted to, again, point out the history here. These were net spreads. That's my grandfather Aaron's original fish house. The gentleman on the far left is my uncle Guy Fulford, who's on my grandmother's side, the Fulford lineage. That today is on our bait boxes. That's our, Village Pride is our brand for bait. So if you're a fishing person and you go into a Walmart or in the Keys, any of the little bait and tackle shops, you'll see bait, and I don't think I included the box, but it says, it produced landed impact in Cortez, Florida. So again, for a tiny little fishing village that some people don't even know, they think of Cortez Road, they don't know Cortez Village, it makes its mark on the world for sure, so it makes me really proud. And that's it. Thank you.
Speakers to join us on stage to answer questions that you've submitted. If you have any additional questions, please hold up your cards in the air and the volunteer will pick them up. All right, we're going to take while they're coming up on stage, I want to know how many people use social media to get the message out. Raise your hand. All right, we're going to do a quick social media moment, and everyone take out their camera phones if you have one. We're going to take a picture of the panel up here. And we're going to post it on your social media page with the hashtag SCW14. Hold on. Everybody sit down. Yep. I'm going to. You got it? All right, everybody smile. Get it? I'm going to take one of you as well. Great. Thank you very much, because we'll be able to share your pictures and spread the word. And let me, all right. Okay, our first question is for Don Hall, and it's submitted by Chris Sherrick. Could restaurants display a window, website sticker, or seal that shows that they are local, like the Chamber of Commerce type badge?
Yeah, some restaurants do. Those that work with John Matthews' business, the Suncoast Food Alliance, which is a small aggregator of produce from local farms, it sells to local restaurants. I would like to see the 10% local food shift be that in a wider way. There's also, not for restaurants yet, but the Sarasota locally grown label that was put out by UF IFAS Extension last year that could also be used for that purpose.
Okay, the next question is for Don and Carmen. Should local food systems issue be a part of this discourse of local and statewide elections and policy development? If so, how can that be done?
I would definitely say sure, absolutely. I think the best way is to contact your local representatives and put pressure on them to make initiatives like the 10% buying local. I know where I'm located in Jacksonville, we've been working in Duval County on the local level with the Food Policy Council there to make a new requirement that we're going for 30% for institutional food, so hospitals and schools and in Duval County would commit to 30%. So we're working on that now. But I think initiatives like that are a good first step. And I think, you know, our agriculture commissioner is up for re-election, and I think Putnam has done a really good job to promote Florida-grown food for Floridians. So researching those candidates and encouraging them to make it easier to improve distribution and processing in our state is a good beginning.
And a good first step that happened recently, Slow Food Greater Sarasota hosted a candidates forum with some county commissioner candidates as well as some state house candidates talking about local food and local elections. And I know that we have that up on the Transition Sarasota website, the candidates' responses to questionnaires. Absolutely, I think it local food addresses a lot of the biggest issues at play in our state today, economy, health, et cetera.
Thank you. The next one is for Karen. Would you speak to the health of the oyster industry in Florida and Apalachicola?
Okay. Right now, the North Florida oyster industry is having a lot of problems. It has to do with the waters coming out of Georgia, and I think the aquifer is impacting or the lack of water in the aquifer is impacting what the beds are experiencing up there. They are producing. The price has gotten really ridiculous. They're safe as far as any type of the Vibrio or the different types of bacteria that they can carry because they're checked by the government regularly, but definitely problems, and it's really related to a larger ecosystem issue than just the bays themselves up there.
Thanks. All right, Don, this is for you. Can you tell us more about the study you'd like to have done? What do you need to make it happen, and what would you expect from some of the outcomes?
Okay. We need about $10,000. So that answers one part of that question.
There you go.
And please come see me or Michael if you have something to contribute or are interested in discussing that possibility. What Michael's former studies have done has looked at what is the general picture now in this area, what are some of the main obstacles to growing the local food system, what would be needed to achieve, whether it's a 25% shift or a 10% shift or whatever, and specifically looking at what would be the capital needs and the policies that could support this, specifically for our area. So I think it would be a very helpful tool, and I think it's something that could help also move local food towards the top of the agenda politically as well.
Thanks. All right, this one's for Karen. Is there a local processor for mullet roe?
There's not a local dryer of the roe. That they started doing it here in the 70s, actually at our facility, but for some reason, I think it was the rules, because they dry it outside. Literally, I have pictures from Taiwan where they roll it out in these big, cute, from warehouses outdoors, and then it's being pressed with basically a piece of some impervious type of a stone. But it wasn't, the area wasn't here, I think, enough room, and the regulations made it difficult to do any type of processing like that. So most of it happens overseas. There has been interest in trying to do it here. Actually, the Manatee County has put some requests in, I think, through the BP funding to look into possibly doing something like that. But at this moment, no, there's only on a personal level.
All right, this one's for you as well. Sometimes I hear about animosity between local fishermen and environmental groups. How can we repair that relationship to achieve common goals?
That's a good question, because truthfully, someone earlier today said about how, I think it was the commissioner, that farmers were your best stewards, or some of your best stewards, or maybe it was you. But anyway, fishermen are also truly, commercial fishermen and recreational fishermen often, are some of your best stewards of the waters or fisheries, because they know the waters more than anyone else. And in more recent years, I think they've worked more closely together, environmental groups and fishermen. They were working together recently on the Longboat Key issue in Manatee County. I know there's some other issues that they've joined forces on, and I think truly if people, I don't know why fishermen, commercial fishermen, seems to have gotten a bad name at one point. I think it's getting better today, even with those TV shows that just make people think about what those people do, the guys do, that it's not the easiest job in the world. But honestly, the ones who are good at their job, they want it there for themselves, for their children in the future, and they're really good environmentalists. So I hope that, I don't know if I answered that, but I don't see them as working against each other. I kind of see them as one and the same.
Hold on the mic, I'm gonna ask you one more question. Has there been a reduction of mullet due to the increased demand for mullet roe?
You know, there was a mullet fishery for roe all the way back in the 30s. They were doing the same type of fishery then. They've gone through periods where they closed roe season down because they worried about the impact on the stocks. But truly, Florida's mullet fishery and the grouper fishery are some of the best and most regulated in the world, and they're both very strong and very sound. So has there been a decrease in the population? Well, there is a lot of pressure on them in that month of December, but the year before my dad died in 2011, he said he had not seen as many fish as he saw in Sarasota Bay from on top of the roof of our fish house since probably the 30s. And that's probably partly a result of gill nets not being there, which, even though that was really detrimental to the culture of the traditional fishers, it's definitely, there's a lot of mullet out there, and the stocks are healthy. Florida will back that up, the Department of FWC, Marine Research Institute.
Okay, Don, this is for you. How do we get the word out to people more effectively, and where do we obtain local food? How and where we obtain local food?
Well, I mentioned our Eat Local Resource Guide and Directory, which you can pick up a copy at the back table there. That has over 250 businesses and organizations, everything from producers of vegetables and herbs, fruit, honey, dairy and eggs, meat and fish, to where you can find it, farmers markets, farm stands, grocery stores, restaurants, to tools that will help you grow your own, such as community gardens or plant nurseries. What was the second part of the question?
Which is, how do we get the word out so people know about your publication?
Tell everybody that you know. I think the best endorsement of a focus on local food is just to have a lot of fun doing it and really enjoy it. And I think when people see us having such a great time with this and thriving, they'll want to jump on the bandwagon.
Okay, this one's for Carmen. How can we accept WIC at Sarasota farmers markets?
So unfortunately, the state of Florida doesn't participate in the WIC CVV program, which is basically coupons that WIC recipients get. So WIC is Women, Infants, and Children. It's one of the federal nutrition assistance programs. And there is the Farmers Market Nutrition Program, which issues checks to WIC recipients from May to July in Florida, but Sarasota County is not one of the participating counties. WIC is moved on to the EBT card now. And so the new readers will be able to accept the WIC benefit. So there is a grant for farmers and farmers markets that provides the reader for free and 2 years of wireless service. So the market or the farmer only has to pay the 15 cents transaction to accept WIC. In Florida, WIC does not allow the purchase of white potatoes. So at a farmer's market, that would be the only item that I would foresee not being eligible.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, I have a question from both Michael and Don. And I don't know if Don wants to come to the, I mean, Michael wants to come to the mic or not, but as, it says, as much as I appreciate and want to support local food, I must admit that I love Trader Joe's. How much damage does an occasional trip to Trader Joe's do to the local food effort?
I don't think Trader Joe's is the devil. And I think we should be looking at this the other way around, but not how much damage does it do to go to Trader Joe's, but what can I do to make a positive impact by supporting local farmers? And I think if we can flip the psychology around and look at this as an opportunity rather than an obligation, that will help out a lot.
Okay, and I have one question left specifically for Michael. I don't know if you want to answer it or not. Okay, it says USDA can pull meat inspectors out of a small meat processing plant due to quote-unquote slow business. How can we encourage well-established government agency to take a progressive approach to local processing operations?
Well, so my answer to this is very legalistic, but I'm a believer in the 10th Amendment, which is about returning power to the states, not on everything, but basically when you're talking about local food, local quality, local standards, it seems to me that a state should be allowed to set its own standards, and then we're going to get much friendlier kinds of regulations to local business, much more responsive to their needs. And the federalization of these food standards, while it, you know, is good for the national food supply, for the local food supplies, has been disastrous for local businesses that can't comport with the high regulatory costs. So in this regard, I think locavores and Tea Party Republicans have a lot in common.
Okay, thank you. Let's give a warm thank you to our panelists today.